How's everybody doing?
Good.
You survived the rain and came in. I appreciate that. Yeah, actually, it's funny because there were many days in London at the Olympics where I'm like, this is the summer games, right? Because it was raining and cold, and I loved it because I really don't like really hot weather. And in Beijing, the entire Summer Olympics, we were just, you know, I brought enough clothes, I thought, for like 2 weeks, and we were doing wash like every day because you're changing like 20 times a day. It was just ridiculous because it was so humid. So let me start by saying I'm lucky. For those of you who've heard this before, I'm lucky. I have two jobs. I have two full-time jobs. I'm the director of marketing at Lexar, and we make the memory cards for the cameras. And I'm also a photographer. So I work 5 days a week at Lexar, and then on weekends I'm shooting. In the case of the Olympics, I'm taking a couple weeks off, and going to the Olympics. Lexar actually has people in the press center supporting the photographers there if they have any issues with their cards. We actually recovered over 50,000 images for people. Most of it, thank God, was not from our brand. It was from somebody else. I won't tell you who. But we were there to help out. And so I manage the team that's there, which means I get to go and as part of Lexar. But then I spent 99% of my time in the field shooting. So the goal of today's presentation is to show you some of the photos from the Olympics, but really talk about it in just general terms and talk about how photography, how you can shoot sports. It doesn't matter whether it's the Olympics, which is, you know, the creme de la creme, right, if you get there. But whether, you know, I started by shooting my kids swimming, playing soccer, whatever. And so most of the tips, 99% of the tips I'm gonna talk about, are pertinent to whatever you're shooting in sports. Anyway, so we're gonna talk about sports photography. And what I wanna do is I want to go through some tips here, but I'm not gonna spend too much time on these because we're gonna go into detail on each of these in a minute. But these are very important, knowing the sport, knowing your camera and its settings, because last thing you want to do is go somewhere and go, oops, how do I get lower the exposure compensation, or how do I switch modes on something? You can't do that. You have to know your camera. Visualizing your image, I do this quite a bit. Before I went to the Summer Olympics, I had pre-visualized, when I shoot this event, I want to shoot it this way. And I'd seen pictures of certain venues and thought, oh, hey, when I get there, I want to do this. So I had thought through how I was to shoot things. I practiced at home on other teams, local teams, and then I'll show you that. Be aware of your background. This is a point, regardless of what you're shooting, honestly. If you're shooting a portrait of someone, and you have a, you know, nice kid in a park, and you have a great shot, and right behind him is a really ugly garbage can, bad idea, right? So you wanna be, one of the things as a photographer I've had to learn over the years of doing this is to look at my background, not just my subject. Now, at the Olympics, you'll see that sometimes you're trying to use the background if you have good Olympic rings, because it tells where you are. But there's other times you have really ugly backgrounds and you want to try to avoid them, so we'll talk about that. Getting the best access. Someone came up to me a couple minutes ago and was talking about shooting sports. They're limited in their access because they're sitting in the stands. So getting good access is very important, sometimes not available. And that's not true of just amateur sports, but even the Olympics, even though I was fully credentialed to the Olympics, we're still limited in where we can go. Yep?
I noticed that in the Olympics, photographers that had the brown dress on, they were off.
Yeah, so there's
the
two.
One with the blue.
Yeah, the blue guys were the pool guys. At the Olympics, there's different levels of credentials. There's what they call an EPS, which is an event photographer for sports specific. So if you're an EPS photographer for diving, you're only in the diving venue the entire time, and you're not allowed to go to other places. The next level, which is the one that I always go for, is the EP, which lets you go to any venue you want. You can wake up in the morning and go, oh, I think I'm gonna go do equestrian, which is really fine because you get the gamut. And then there's the blue vest, and oh, by the way, and you're required to wear a vest. If you don't wear a vest, you don't shoot, because that's how they can tell from a distance who belongs, who doesn't. The blue vests were for the pool photographers from Associated Press, Reuters, Getty, and some of the other agencies from Europe. So those guys get a little different access, but even only some of those guys. And they'll allow, like for opening ceremonies, 99% of the photographers are in the stands for that part. And some of the blue vested guys have to dress in all black, and they're allowed in the middle of the opening ceremonies, but very, very few. So there is a different level of credential. And so access can vary, even at places like the Olympics, it can vary. Getting in tight, very important when you're shooting sports, take a longer lens, and I'll show you why. It's nice to get in close to the action. And a lot of people show me images and say, what do you think of this one? And I look at it and go, you know, but you're seeing 20 people, but who am I supposed to be looking at? What's your subject? Practice ahead of time, very, very important. knowing where your light is coming from. If you're shooting on the west side of a stadium and the light is coming from the other direction, ouch. But if that's all you can do, you have to work around it. But if you can move, try to move into a better position. Look for interesting shots that are different. And this is really tough at the Olympics. You have 2,200 photographers from all over the world. And most of them are really, really good photographers. And so you're trying to find something different from the guy next to you is shooting. It's not easy. Try different lenses. Try breaking the rules. It's funny because in photography, they have the rule of thirds. And they have this rule. And you always want the eyes in focus. And you know what? Sometimes you don't. Sometimes it's fun just to say, you know what? I'm going to do it totally different. Yesterday, I had 3 hours free to myself. I walked over to MoMA, never been there before. Didn't quite get all the artwork in there, but whatever. Right? It's art, to each his own. But you know, I really had fun shooting the people walking around the museum. So I held really tight to my camera, did motion blur, and you know, and just tried to break the rules and do something different. So I wasn't shooting the artwork, I was more shooting the people looking at the artwork. And here's the key thing, and that's have fun. And you know, I get to use really good equipment. I get to shoot amazing things, and I don't take it for granted. I truly appreciate every opportunity that I have when I'm out there. But I'm having fun. So even though I was contractually obligated to Team USA to shoot for USA water polo at the Olympics, when I wasn't shooting water polo, which was generally the night, I'm hauling my butt out to go shoot as many other sports as I could because it's fun. And I get to experience history in the making at the Olympics. So whether it's there or at home, there's times where I'll just be bored, I'll grab my camera, go shoot the bees outside in the backyard, just because I love it. So, knowing the sport, and this is probably the most important thing for doing sports photography, is you need to know the game, at least in its basics, at very least. So, I shot for USA Hockey in Vancouver Olympics, and when I was talking to USA Water Polo 2 years ago about shooting the Summer Games in London, they said, well, do you know water polo? We've seen your portfolio, we love it, looks good, let's talk, but do you know water polo? And I said, I really don't, I've shot some, but I don't know the sport well enough yet, but I promise you that a year and a half from now when the Olympics come around, I'll know it backwards and forwards. I even thought about playing it just to learn it, because I play hockey, so I knew how to anticipate the game. But what I did was, I took my our friend who goes to high school, my son, and she came with me. I'd call her up. They're family friends of ours. I'd call her parents. Can I borrow CJ again? And she'd sit next to me, and we'd go to like games. And I'd say, like, what was that whistle for? What just happened there? You know, what am I supposed to be looking at here? And I'd be shooting. She'd be talking to me and telling me what was happening. I learned to predict the play. When I shot for USA Hockey in the Olympics in Vancouver, the puck would come around the boards. Well, I play hockey. If that puck comes around the board and stops right here, I know that those players come flying in, right in the boards at me. So I drop the 70 to 200 on the big camera, grab my 5D Mark II with a fisheye, hold it up and spray and get the shot, which I'll show you. But if I didn't know the game and that puck came around and I still had a long lens and they're 1 foot from me, right, you're not gonna get the shot. No good shooting positions. Again, sometimes you have access to them, sometimes you don't, but if you do, find them, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. The other thing is, if you want to practice a sport, let's say it's football, and you've never shot it, go to a local high school or elementary school, go to the field, find out who's in charge, and say, can I shoot on the field, please? And 99% of the time, they'll say yes, especially if you say, I'll give you the images for the yearbook or whatever you want them for free. But if you want them, you got them, and it's a great way to practice. And I still do this. It's funny, because I went to our local high school, and shot like, I don't know, 3 or 4 months ago, or 6 months ago, whatever it was. And my wife goes, you're not gonna get access on the field because the game had already started. And I'm like, what do you mean? It's a high school game. I'm an Olympic photographer. Well, they don't really care or not. But I walked over and they see the giant lens. They're like, cool, who's this guy? And again, I offered images and it was like, hey, all the field is yours. So try that. Just don't get run over. Yeah, actually, that is a good point when you're shooting sports. You're looking through a hole this big. Be very careful when you're shooting sports like field hockey with those balls come flying at you, or ice hockey if you're not behind glass. That hurts. I've broken my nose and my foot, and yeah. Okay, so let's talk about practicing. So before I shot in 2008 Summer Olympics, this is our local swim club. It's about a couple blocks from my house. I went there and started shooting. That's actually my daughter right there. And I wanted to know, what is my shutter speed? Typically for sports, I'll shoot 500th of a second, or maybe 1,000th of a second to freeze the action. Okay, so I know that I'm looking at light. What swimming is better? Freestyle? No, because they barely, like, you took a Michael Phelps who breathed once, right? Where my wife is, my daughter's breathing every stroke almost. These guys are amazing. So this one's a tough sport to shoot. But if you look at something like butterfly, oh wait, they're coming all the way out of the water. It's a much better stroke to shoot. If I hadn't practiced on the local swim club, I wouldn't have known that. Now here's the bad part. I figured out that the best way to shoot butterfly is straight on and low, which is what this is. Then I got to the Olympics and found out there's no shooting position straight on and low. You're off to the side and stuff, so you have to kind of rethink things a little bit. But I knew that that was the best stroke to get a picture of someone like Michael Phelps.
Did you use flash in that?
No, well, that one there, no. And at the Olympics, flash is not allowed. So no tripods and no flash, and if you bring it, they'll kick you out. They'll take your credentials and send you home. No tripods. The reason they don't allow tripods is, you know, your shooting positions are very short and narrow, and you're running around each other, so they don't want legs extended, plus it gets in the way of fans, and you're carrying all that stuff, and they don't want it. Monopod, yes, tripods, no. Here's the weird thing about the Olympics, is literally, you could tell in Taipei, you don't stop. You go 9 in the morning till 2 in the morning every day. It's the only time I've ever eaten just to live versus living to eat. I mean, I literally was just, you don't walk. You literally run to a press bus, you run to the next event, you run, and you waste no time. On the bus, you're editing. As soon as you get off the bus, you put your laptop away, and you get off the next one bus, and you whip it back open, and you start going through again. And then, like, at the restaurant I would go to by my condo, I always ate dinner around 11:30 at night. The restaurant was closed, they were nice, and they let me eat there. They gave me their Wi-Fi password at this Indian place, so I could eat my dinner and post till 1 in the morning, and then I'd go back and go to sleep around 2 and do it again, and it's just, it's hard to actually come back because you're mentally and physically just drained, but it's so much fun that you can't complain, trust me. I'll get back to you in a minute. I just want to keep it moving, but I'll get you in a sec. So before the Winter Olympics, it was easy. Like I said, I play hockey, so I understand that game, but I still went and shot some of the San Jose Sharks games. And as I mentioned, no flash. Well, a lot of times we shoot NHL games, we shoot with strobes. So we're actually using a pocket wizard and we're remotely firing a flash in the rafters that's down on the ice and then lighting the ice so we can get really good lighting. Well, the Olympics doesn't allow that. Not only that, but we in the NHL, you shoot through a hole in the glass. IOC doesn't allow that in the Olympics. You're shooting through plexi. So I went and started shooting no flat, you know, no strobe, wide open, through plexi, just to practice. And these are just some of the shots I was just shooting. And then before this, I started with kids. So this is my neighbor. I went and shot one of his games. And then I went and did some of the girls at the local high school down the street, started shooting, and then progressed and worked my way up to the US Open. This was for USA Water Polo. This is down in Los Angeles. I flew down there and shot this for them. Good thing was it was great because you had guys that were, you know, Olympic quality athletes that could really come out of the water really high. Problem was the lighting was horrible at these events. All I could tell USA Water Polo was, boy, I can't wait to the Olympics because it's indoors. I'll have nice, even light throughout. Oh, and detail shots. When you're shooting sports, don't just shoot the athletes. Look around you. Look for details. Look for the coach's reaction. Look for the fans' reaction. And I'll show you some images I got in that respect. So knowing your camera is really, really important. How many people here feel like they know their camera 100%? Pretty good. I don't even know mine 100%. I use probably 75% of the settings and some of the stuff I just don't care about. I don't need it. But you do want to know the basics and all, you know, you can't sit there and have to think, okay, how do I get to shutter priority? Or how do I adjust this setting? It's got to be innate. And when I went to the Olympics in London, I used the 1DX, two of the new Canon 1DX cameras. Well, they had just come out. They sent me a prototype to play with, thank God. So I had learned it enough that it was inherent. I didn't have to sit there and think, okay, now what do I do? So because once you get to the games, like I said, there's no stopping. You're just spray and pray. You just go. Speaking of spray and pray, burst mode. I always shoot in burst mode, even when I'm shooting portraits. And the reason is, when I shoot portraits, I do boom, 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 boom. So I get all the eyes open, not just half open, but fully open, and everybody looks good. Yeah, that's the one I want. I'll take that one out of the five. So I always keep it in a burst mode. Now, I'll say that because I usually shoot with a 5D Mark III or 5D Mark II. With a 1DX, which shoots 12 frames a second, that might be a little overkill for portrait. Here, stay there. Good job, right there. Brrr, I still put it in a slower burst mode on a 1DX, but always in burst mode. And if I just want one shot, I'll just press the button quickly and get one or two shots. That's fine. But I always keep my camera in a burst mode. Focus modes. When you're shooting sports, most of the time, I'm shooting in with servo focus or variable focus so that it's automatically moving as the subject is either coming to or away from me. And we'll talk about when I don't do that, but I do that quite often. The other thing you'll find, and this is true of pretty much everybody at the Olympics, we don't use the shutter button as focusing. We do what's called back focusing. So we turn off the shutter button and we make the AF button on the back focusing. That way I can use this finger to determine when I want to focus and let off, and this button to actually shoot the image. That way I could, if I want to track someone the whole way, I'll keep the button down and fire. But if I have a water polo player and they're in one position with a ball, I can lock the focus, maybe move my camera so they're off center and still be firing and get them in focus. Does that make sense? Okay.
You always use the center point?
Do I always use center point? 90% of the time I use center point focus. One thing I can't stand is why these camera manufacturers ship the cameras with the entire spectrum lit up. Because like the camera thinks, oh, okay, so you want to focus on the garbage can, right? I mean, no. So whenever someone will show me their brand new SLR, the first thing I do is go, okay, here's how you change that mode. And I'll put it in center focus. So generally it'll be in center focus. The time I don't do center focus, I'll cover that in a minute, but I'll show you. I do switch it up.
Use the expanded focus modes or just the center?
Depends. Do I use expanded focus mode or center? It depends on what sport I'm shooting. So one of the challenges with shooting water polo is half the game is underwater. The other half of the game is above water, but you have splashes coming up in front of your athletes. So depending on how I'm shooting, I would try different modes. And I'll show you those. Choices of lenses. You want to be open to trying different lenses. You know, like when I shot BMX, I shot a lot of it with a 400, real long lens. And then after about an hour of shooting, I thought, this is just not doing it for me. And I switched to a 16 to 35 wide, went to a different position, and I like those images better. And I'll show you those. White balance, we'll talk about memory cards. As I mentioned, I'm the director of marketing at Lexar. I have to at least tell you a little bit about memory cards. But believe it or not, and I'll talk about it in a minute, it makes a big difference in the way that I shoot. So this is my equipment. It's a long list. I don't take all this with me. I guarantee that. But I do use Canon. I have two 5D Mark IIIs. As I mentioned, for the Olympics, I was lucky enough to get two 1DXs. The lenses, my go-to lens for almost everything is the 70-200 2.8. I love that lens. The 100-400 works in a pinch. It's not the sharpest lens, but it's not bad. And for general sports at home, I'll use that lens quite a bit. 24-105 I use a lot for portraits. 16-35 I want to go wide. Same thing with the Sigma fisheye. I like that one. That one's for doing some cool wide stuff. You'll see some images from that. For portraits, one of my other favorites is that 85. The Sigma 85 1.4 is awesome. For the money, it is incredible to be able to shoot at 1.4 and get some really, really cool images. And it's a little bit lighter, so which I like too. And I've got the gamut. I do have the Sigma 120-300 2.8. It's a fairly new lens. I used that when I shot the Olympic trials, the gymnastic trials in San Jose, and got some. If you look at how many people have been on my blog. So if you go to jeffcable.com and go to my blog, and if you're on Facebook, just join the Facebook page. And I blog. I try to blog at least once a week. At the Olympics, I'm blogging twice a day. But you can go back and read all the stories of my behind the scenes at the Olympics, which lens I used, why I used it, whether I got in trouble or not, or what I was up to.
So you don't use the
2x extender? Never use a 2x extender. Don't even own one.
Why? You don't want to lose the 2x.
I don't want to use the full stop, that much light, and just never had a need for it, honestly.
You use the Sigma extender only with Sigma?
So yes. Yes, with the Sigma lens, I do use a Sigma extender.
24-70 yeah. Sigma, how do you compare that to the Canon?
24-70 Sigma is very sharp, good bokeh on it, nice lens. Does that have IS? I don't remember if it does. I never, you know, I don't need IS with a 2470, honestly. When I shoot wide, I don't really care about IS. Here's the other thing. At the Olympics, I turned IS off. Never used it in sports because I'm on a monopod. It's faster without IS turned on. It tends to focus a little bit quicker. So I saw no photography at the Olympics using IS. How about that? Unless you're handheld, a little different. I've got two of the 600 flashes from Canon. You know, I also have the 580s, to be honest with you. I don't use the wireless remote triggering that often, so, I mean, they're nice, they work. Gitzo, I love their tripods because they're light. I also use their monopod as well. Low pro bags, and of course, Lexar, of course. And I shot a lot. At the Olympics, I shot 78,000 images. During the games, kept about 38,000. And I blew through 128 gig cards like they were going out of style. When we made those cards, I thought, this is ridiculous. No one's gonna need 128 gig. Well, I did.
Are you shooting RAW?
I shoot full RAW. I'm one of the few photographers at the Olympics that shoots not JPEG, but RAW. And the reason is because I had so many cards, why not? But you know, RAW, there's so much more data in RAW that when I shoot the Olympics, I feel like it's a once in a lifetime opportunity. Now granted, I've done three, but I treat it, I still am in awe when I'm there. You get to experience the Olympics. I mean, from the inside, it's awesome. Why not shoot it for the best possible images? So I shoot everything RAW. And I have a lot of hard drive space at home. Actually, that's the next slide. This is my setup at home. I've got a Mac Pro tower. It's getting a little old, but it still works well. It's probably about 3 years old. 30-inch display, which is awesome because I can really see that image big. How many people here know what a solid-state drive is? SSD. Okay. Solid-state drives are basically a memory card that replaces your hard drive. It's all flash memory, but there's no spinning and moving parts, and it's fast. My machine boots up in like a third the time as if I had a hard drive. But here's the kicker. This is my scratch disk for Photoshop. So Photoshop runs way faster. Everything runs faster. So I've got four drive bays in this machine. Drive one, which is the solid-state drive, is just my operating system and my apps and my scratch disk. No, this is a 256 gig drive. This drive is just operating system and Photoshop scratches and apps, which is maybe 150 gig tops. So there's a lot of spare stuff here. Now behind it, I've got three terabyte drives. So I've got 9 terabytes of images on that machine. So that's that. I've also got a 10 terabyte Drobo for backing up. I've got 2 4-terabyte external Western Digital drives, which I crisscross between my home and Lexar. That way, if I have a fire in one location, I still have all my images. So you want to try to back up your images remotely, if possible. I do use the USB 3.0 readers from Lexar. They're fast. And with the new Mac, which has USB 3, at the Olympics, and if you look at my blog, I actually blogged it one day about what is a typical day at the Olympics and how did technology help me. But with USB 3.0 on this machine, with 2 readers hooked up, I was moving 15 gigabytes per minute. Now you have to remember, when I'm shooting for USA, Team USA, I'm contractually obligated to have images back to the United States within 2 hours of every game. Well, when you're shooting 2,500 images, that means you have to go through those, find those key 15 images, retouch them, which just means exposure and stuff like that. It doesn't mean you can clone stuff out. The IOC doesn't allow that. But you're just fixing color and white balance and correction. And then you get all those, and you resize them, FTP them back to the US. And with this, I was able to do it, downloading, going through them, and editing and getting them to the US within 1 hour.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm using the new MacBook Pro with Retina, with USB 3.0, with 1000X cards. And the combination was just, seriously, life-changing.
How many wrenches you have in that computer?
How much RAM? 8 gig. And that's enough. It works. We'll talk about that in a second. Actually, that's the next slide. What program? I'll show you. Epson R2000 is my printer at home. Love that thing. It's $500, and I print a ton of my own stuff, and it's just great. I am absolutely hooked on Wacom tablets. If you haven't used a Wacom tablet, you haven't lived. It is, I'm one of the few photographers who brings these with me to the Olympic Games. I have one at the press center, one at the press center at the water polo, and one at my condo. And I only edit with these tablets, unless I was on a bus. It was too hard to have one, but unbelievable. All right, what do I use? The software I use, I do not use Lightroom or Aperture, and the reason is they're too slow. I used a program called PhotoMechanic. I will tell you that every photographer I saw at the Olympics uses PhotoMechanic. Now, what PhotoMechanic does is it's very simple. It lets you go through your images at very high speed, look at what you want. Actually, I got an image of it, I think, right here. No, I don't. I'll show it to you. It lets you go through your images really fast, pick the ones you want and the ones you don't want. Simple as that. And you can crop. You can do some other stuff too. You can FTP, you can also save as JPEG and do stuff like that. But mainly, it's for picking your images. And for all of us at the Olympics, it's all about speed. It used to be, if you got images of someone within a day, they were happy. But now with the internet, USA Water Polo wanted to have those images on Facebook in 45 minutes after the game. They wanted to say, hey, the USA woman just won the game. Here's the stats, here's what happened. So-and-so just scored 3 goals. Well, they want the picture of her shooting and scoring the goal. So they're looking at me like, hurry up. So literally, as I said, we don't walk. The game's over, I'm running from the game area around to what's called the mix zone, and that's where the athletes come through and get interviewed. So I'm shooting interview shots, and then I'm looking at my contact from USA Water Polo, and he goes, and that means get out of here. You've got all of our athletes, there's no one else coming, go. So I'd run, grab my camera. Now I'm running up to the press center, which is upstairs, dumping my stuff, getting my stuff out of my locker, and plugging everything in, and downloading. And while I'm downloading, I might run to the restroom or something, run back, hope to God everything's going, and then just go. And it's literally, it's a frantic pace. And when the woman won the gold medal, it was till 4 in the morning. It was keep going, because then USA Today wanted image. It was just mayhem. So speed, all about speed. So to me,
camera raw is not bridge. I mean, it's not
even camera raw. Even with raw, in this, it's so fast, it doesn't matter. Yeah, I'll show you afterwards if you remind me. I'll show it to you. It's incredibly fast. That's actually a picture of the old box. I got to update that. But it is great, 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 awesome stuff. So speed is critical. Shutter speed. As I mentioned, I like to shoot around 1/1000th of a second. I believe this is at 1250th of a second. I did shoot full manual because I shot every USA water polo game, men's and women's. I got it down to a science. I figured out exactly what the settings needed to be. I did shoot with the 1DX at 12 frames a second. Definitely helps to get that peak of action. But I love the way it freezes the arcs of the, you know, the water. Very cool.
How do you avoid seeing the shutter curtain?
What's that?
The curtain?
Yeah.
How do you avoid seeing that flash in the shot?
No, you don't have to worry about that. If you're shooting at that speed, 1,000 a second, you don't have, without flash, you turn your ISO up to 1,200 or 1,600, you're fine.
It's only when you use a flash that you have?
Well, if you're using a flash, you have shutter issues, you don't in this mode at all. It's easy.
If you shoot at 250, anything above 250?
Yeah, if you shoot at 250 with a flash, you're going to blow everything out, or 300.
You see the shutter at it.
You'll see it with a flash. You won't see the shutter here.
Okay.
Only with a flash. So here, again, I'm aiming for really fast shutter speed. Now, of course, here I'm outdoors. I could have been 1/4000th of a second. Wouldn't matter. And this is using the new or upcoming Canon 200 to 400 lens, which I absolutely fell in love with. I just blogged about it this week. I think they don't know how much it's going to cost. It could be up to like 12 grand or something. I hope it isn't. But it's. I fell in love.
What's the speed?
That's going to cost me.
2.8 or 4?
It's F4 from 200 to 400, but it's got built-in tele adapter in it. So literally you flip a switch and it becomes a 1.4 switch and it becomes a 560 millimeter at F5.6. So the cool thing was for shooting water polo, when they swam toward me, I was at the 200, 400 mode, boom, 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 shooting. Well, then let's say they scored and then they go the other direction. Now they're playing defense and now they're on the other side of the pool. For me, I just flipped the switch. Now I'm at 560 millimeters, unbelievable. Yeah, I mean, it was addictive. And I can only check it out numerous times because Canon brings all the stuff that we get to borrow. And I was like, I need that lens again. They go, you already borrowed it too many times. So I'm like, please. And then, so then they told me, okay, if you guys make gold medal, you can have it for that game. I'm like, done. So the woman made the gold medal mount. And I went to him the day before and said, I want it today just to make sure I have it. And they were cool with it. But I mean, it was awesome. It's going to cost me. I already told my wife, I go, just expect $12,000 to be gone. So again, peak of action, you know, sometimes you get lucky in the reactions, but you want to be able to freeze it. Sometimes you don't. In this case, this is Serena Williams. I went and shot at Wimbledon just because I always wanted to shoot center court Wimbledon. Only reason. I thought, how cool would that be? And of course, that's where tennis was during the Olympics. So I went over there and I shot center court, and then I went over to court one where she was playing, and I shot this. And I shot her for about half an hour, 45 minutes, and it started getting boring. I mean, I got all these shots, freezing Serena, you know, hitting the ball, and I'm like, okay, now what? So what I did was I did the opposite, and I turned the camera to the point where I'm shooting at maybe a hundredth of a second instead of a thousandth of a second, so I can get the motion of the ball and the motion of the swing. And I do it for two reasons. One, I think it's more interesting, but two, it keeps me awake. It gives me a new challenge. Actually, yesterday when I was at MoMA, that's what I did. I shot everything at like 20th of a second, just to have fun. Same thing with the velodrome. I shot stuff where I froze them, but I thought, you know what? I'm gonna do something different. So I pre-focused on the Olympic rings, because when you're at the Olympics, you wanna use those to your advantage because it tells where you are. So I pre-focused on them, went to like F16 at ISO probably 400, which gave me enough blur to get these guys, and it shows kind of successive blur through the image, and that's what I wanted. I shot, if you guys come this afternoon to the night photography one, I shot at the Met with a tripod, and they did not like that. Get out of here. I'm like, why? I don't know, but get out of here. And then I said to the guy, I said, well, what are you gonna do? And he goes, well, I'll get my boss. I'll get the sergeant. I said, well, okay, go get him. How long does it take? He goes, 5 minutes. I said, go get him. So he went and got him. I shot all my images, and then the sergeant comes, he goes, you can't do that. I go, okay. So this here was during the track and field, or what they call in London, athletics. And I shot a bunch. This was like the 5,000 meter where they were running around and around and around. And I shot some safe shots of them going around. I thought, you know, I'm gonna slow it down a little bit and just try to do what's called motion pan. How many people here have done motion pan? You guys live in the perfect place. Go to Times Square and just stand there and do taxi cabs. That's how I learned. I just sit there and you swivel your hips, follow the cabs. 20th of a second, 50th of a second, depends, and just play and try it. Central Park, follow the horse and carriages and shoot that, it's really fun. But so this one here, you can tell I was actually pointing directly on her, that's why these guys are blurred. I'm going the exact same speed as she is, and what's your take rate? Trust me, not every image came out, right? But all I care about is one, that one. It got a cool motion in their feet, it was really nice that they wore those colored shoes, I requested that. I told them, please wear yellow shoes. You know, it worked out.
You're still in burst mode.
I am still in burst mode. Oh yeah, it's brrr. Yeah, it is. We call it spray and pray. When you shoot sports in 12 frames a second, it's like brrr. Oh, I hope I got that one shot where it was like that. You know.
But you just go across like that.
Yeah, I'm staying with her, and it's like golf. You want follow through. So as you're doing this, you're going brrr, and you stay with them even if you stop shooting. Keep that motion so you get, and you're trying to stay with them. When I follow taxi cabs like I did yesterday in front of Radio City, just having some fun, I kind of go off the numbers on the side of the cab. And if that number's perfectly tack sharp, then you got the exact same speed. Same thing here. I was shooting the equestrian, the horse jumping, really great venue in London. And I was shooting, and I was using the 100 to 400 because the second day I went out there, I honestly was just lazy. I was tired of carrying giant lenses. I'd been there for 2 weeks. My back was sore. You're walking 10 or 15 miles a day, and I thought, you know what, I'm gonna relax today for the morning, I'm gonna go over to the equestrian and just take a small lens. So I brought 100-400. Problem was, there wasn't enough separation between the athlete and the background, because I'm shooting at 5-6. Well, what I figured was, okay, well, instead, I'll just go at 50th of a second, or whatever I did, and slow it down, and do the panning with the athlete, so I'd be focusing on their head, and you see motion everywhere else except for them. And a good motion blur shot, you get the face in focus, and if I were to zoom in on that, you'd see it's sharp, and everything else has motion in it. And it makes it more fun, it's more interesting. So we talked about continuous shooting. I almost always shoot this way. This is my daughter's friend playing soccer. I did this for a Lexar piece just to show why you want burst mode. And why you want it is for things like this. If you were to shoot one shot, it's not likely you're gonna get peak of action every time. It's cheating when you're using something like a 1DX because at 12 frames a second, you can do this. But I will tell you, I shoot a lot of sports with a 5D Mark II or III. Three frames a second, 5 frames a second. You can still do it, not a problem. Don't think you have to have a 1DX. Does it help? Yes. It also hinders because it means you have to go through 2,800 images after every game. And let me tell you, there are times when I was shooting when I would go brrrr and nothing would happen. Like they'd be faking like they're gonna shoot and then they'd pass. So I got like, you know, 2,800 shots of a guy like faking. I'm like, come on, shoot the ball. You know, and so I'd have to, you know, delete, you know. But in the case, sometimes, I mean, look how, I mean, these kids are amazing how strong they are. But, you know, they come out, they're not standing at the bottom of the pool, they're treading water, it's incredible. But you look at the shot, you got water coming off the ball, you got the, you know, full action there. And you're not going to get that without shooting in burst mode. Same thing here. I have the shot of him going here, 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 here. That's the one I want. Sometimes I'll delete the first couple and the last couple, but I'll keep the middle section. This one here, Betsy, the goalie for the US team, you could tell that she made that stop. And so that's the shot I'm looking for, and that is a burst of a lot of shots. I got her, doom, 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 that, ball leaving. But that's the one they want. That's the one I wanted to give them. This is my brother-in-law. Again, peak of action right at the top of his jump. One of the great things, and one of the horrible things about being a photographer is when all your relatives are like, hey, we're gonna go boating, you wanna come? Can you bring your camera? I get invited to more parties. My wife will call me, hey, so-and-so just invited this party. And they ask, can you bring your camera? Yeah, no problem. And it's cool. I mean, you get to shoot images for people and give it to them. I love doing it. This one here I shot at a hockey game in Boise. And it's funny because this is not during the game, right? You'd think like, well, you would not be in burst mode now, would you? Yeah, I would. And actually, good thing, because right as I shot, the guy with no teeth right in the front there smiled. And you know what? Good thing I didn't have it in single shot mode. So as I said, I always keep it in burst mode. I talked about memory cards. I'm not trying to drill this down your throat because I'll tell you when things are good and when they're not. If you have a 30D camera, you do not need a 1000X card unless you want fast downloading. But if you have one of the newer cameras, like if you have a 5D Mark III or a 1DX or one of the new Nikons, it makes a huge difference because it clears the buffer faster. So if you take action at a sporting event and I'm shooting, let's take short track speed skating, they're going around, it's like and then again, or the girl in the balance beam at the summer games, you know, she's doing her jumps and I'm just firing off. I'm not waiting for the buffer to clear. And when I shot the Olympic trials, the guy next to me shooting for one of the news services had an older card and he was firing off when he was waiting. Waiting means Gabby just did her amazing move and you missed it. So to me, that's huge. Although arguably at the Olympics, I think it was more important afterwards and be able to download at twice the speed as it was even in camera. It was kind of a combination of both. So, and these things are like $39 here or something. They're not expensive, but you want to get a good reader. Most people do not understand, most photographers, even the Olympics don't get, that if you take a fast card and put it into an old reader, you're doing yourself no good. If you take this card, which can move 120 meg per second, put it to an old reader, you might only get 6 meg a second out of it. So, yeah, there it is. There's my pitch. Know your focus modes. As I mentioned, the difference between single focus and follow focus or servo focus. I typically do use center dot. The times I don't use center dot is when I don't want to have the picture centered, right? So if I got that water polo player that you saw before, which is off center, I may have moved it over here to try to get something different, okay? The other time I'll do it is I'll move the dots to something like this is if I'm shooting portraits of someone because now I'm going to have this tilted this way and it's going to be right on her face. So that's the time I'll move it. A lot of times when I'm shooting portraits though, I'll do this. I'll half press the button with the center point on their eye and then move the camera a little bit and then fire it down the rest of the way. But so I can just...
Can you do that when you're in the...
No, well if I'm back focusing, yes. But when I shoot portraits, I don't usually back focus. I use back focus for sports. But for portraits, I just hold down the shutter button and then...
Can you do that in burst mode, hold the shutter and keep the...
Burst mode, yes. Servo focus, no. Because servo focus, the minute you move the camera, it's going to be focusing on something different. So for fixed focus, that works great for portraits and things. For sports, won't work. White balance. White balance is brutal. I shoot an auto white balance most of the time and don't worry about it till later because I shoot everything raw. But in certain environments, that's a pain. One of them is indoor sports like basketball or hockey, where you get this really yellowish, brutal light, and that gets corrected to like that. And you can do that when you shoot raw, you can pull the temperature slider to go cooler or warmer. Or you can do something like an expo disc, which I do sometimes use, or a white card where you can shoot against white and then tell your camera, this is white. And then shoot. Or if I forgot a white card, I'd borrow him and say, turn around for a second, I'd focus on your shirt, and then say, that's white. Or find someone with a kind of a grayer shirt, you can use that too. But that's you want to adjust white balance. And I'll tell you that at the Olympics, as I mentioned, they don't allow us to clone things and move things or remove, you know, acne or whatever. You can't do that. They don't allow it. But we can adjust white balance and hue. And almost the weird thing at the water polo venue was, every image was very green, and certain parts of the pool were greener than others. So we had to keep pulling not only the white bounce, but magenta. It was bizarre. Myself and the guys from Associated Press were sitting there. We experimented the first day. Is it magenta? Where are we going? We figured it out. Every image, we had to pull it. So I talked about visualizing your image. I love doing this because it makes me more creative. I noticed some of my images that I shot the week before in our swim meet for our kids, that when they did the backstroke and they took off backwards, they all blew bubble. The better swimmers were blowing bubbles out of their nose. I thought, how cool is that to get that trail? So the next time I went to the swim meet, that's all I shot for backstroke. I stood up on the diving block as they took off and just brr, brr, as they took off to get the trail, just to make it something for me. When I went to the Winter Olympics, before I even went to the games, I saw online what it looked like for curling. Now, curling is not the most incredible, amazing sport to shoot because there's not a whole lot of action. There's no fighting, checking. That would be really, really cool, wouldn't it? What if they had curling with checking? But I love the rings and I like the composition. So I actually pre-visioned 2 months before Olympics, I want to shoot something like this, and went and did it. Same thing with the Winter Olympics. This was opening ceremonies. The way it works at opening ceremonies is they do two practices. And the 50,000 people that are in the stadium are sworn to secrecy. Well, you know how people are, right? 16 gigs speaks volumes. Hey, who needs a card? So I'll go to someone who went to practice and go, you probably need a larger memory card, don't you? What's the key thing I need to know about opening ceremonies? Okay, at the very beginning, a guy comes through on the snowboard and jumps through the rings. Great, here, have a memory card. Whatever, I mean, you know, people talk. And so you find out, what do I need to know? And that was what I needed to know. So I was posed, ready to go. As soon as the game started, the guy came through, boom, and I shot that shot. This one here, I went to the bobsled track about 4 hours before it started, and I walked the whole track. And I actually talked to the photo manager and said, you know, tell me about your track. And he told me, and I go, and he goes, oh, there's four turns that have the rings, 3, 6, 9, and 16. So I walked the track and looked. I don't want to get the shot without the rings because then it could be bobsled anywhere. So I went to those turns, looked at them, and then when the competition started, I went pretty much to 3, 6, 9, and 16 and shot there. Got lucky, got my USA guys there as well. So in London, I had seen this online that they put the rings on Tower Bridge. You guys probably all saw this too because it was all over the news. And so I knew I wanted to get this shot, and when my wife and I were still being tourists before the games, I went and shot this. But I had this in my mind for quite a while. But I also had this in mind. I thought, what can I do that's different? Because everybody has this shot. I mean, a lot of people have that shot. So I thought, what can I do that's different? So I went to the bridge directly across from Tower Bridge, and I rolled the zoom during the exposure. So literally, it's open for 3 or 4 seconds, and during the exposure, you kind of just turn the zoom on the lens, and you create that effect. Some people don't like it. Some people do.
On a tripod.
Yeah, all my night stuff's on a tripod. Yeah, but it's different. This one here, we have to be in position 3 hours before opening and closing ceremonies, which is really a pain. They start at 9 o'clock at night or whatever, and you're there at, you know, 6, or you have to leave the press bus at 4:30. I mean, it's a long day. And so you're sitting there and you're like, okay, well, what's gonna happen? Well, obviously you know that fireworks are coming because they always do. So I had my 1DX, I had my 5D Mark III. On the 5D Mark III, I put my fisheye lens. I pre-focused like up into the stands here. And at night, once it got dark, I metered it and thought, okay, I'll go a little bit darker because I know that this is gonna overpower otherwise. And then once the fireworks started, it was just, you know, 2 hours later, just hold up the camera and just spray and pray. Boom, 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 boom. And I'm right next to this railing, which you can barely see. And because I'm on a fisheye, you can see everything, right? Your shoes and so I'm holding out like this. I'm not even looking, I'm just firing it. But I knew 2 hours before what I wanted. I talked about background. Background is very important. This is one of the few racetracks in the world, I believe, that actually has blue sky behind a turn. So I positioned myself in the right place to get just blue sky behind. I actually was shooting for the Target race team because right here on the nose cone is the Lexar logo. So because we sponsor them, I get access to the track. So here's a shot, kids soccer. This is my wife in the background. I'm working hard, and she's over there having coffee and enjoying herself, but she's ruining my background. So what do you do, right? You know, it's a kid's playground, it's at a school. Like, oh man, and now you got cars and junk in the background, right? So how do you avoid that? Long lens would help.
Wide aperture.
Wide aperture, if you've got a very expensive, good, big lens, yeah, if you have an extra 10 grand in your pocket, you could do that. You can also move, try to get, you know, people out of it. The other thing you can do is just get down and really low to the grass, which is what I did. Actually, I'm on my elbows, shooting very low, which is cool because it uses that depth of field because everything else is out of focus except for them. The other advantage of getting down low is it makes your athletes bigger. They look stronger, faster. But the other thing is it brings you into the action. If you look at this shot, we're kind of over it and above it because I'm about 6 feet tall. Here, I'm down into the action. It's a totally different look. It's probably 5 minutes later.
Did you move from the spot?
Nope, I did not. Same spot, other than from up here to down. No difference.
What lens did you use?
I think that was the 100 to 400 or the 70 to 200, and I don't remember. From the aperture, it looks like it's probably the 70 to 200. This one here, I wanted the background. In Beijing, they had this great Beijing 2008. Right behind him, I went in during practice, this guy was practicing, and I shot it, I got him right there laying down for me, which was very nice of him, with the logo in the background, because I want to say this is where it was shot. Same thing here in Vancouver, I framed it as this guy was doing this because I wanted the Olympic rings in the Vancouver 2010 to be just a little bit out of focus, but noticeable. I want him still to be the point of the subject of the image, but I want you to see in the background just a little hint of that.
That's all natural light?
Yeah, because you can't shoot flash. Now, one of the advantages of the Olympics is they light it really good, because NBC says so. Yeah, the broadcasters definitely make sure that we have good lighting. Here's another example of that. The one cool thing about fencing at the Olympics is they use theatrical lighting. So they black out the backgrounds really dark, and then they light this. It was really cool. So what I did in this case, I was shooting from different angles, and I saw the flags just a little bit lit in the back, and I thought, that's kind of cool. So I moved to a different position, because you kind of have a little bit of mobility in this venue. And I got this athlete. The US and the British actually painted their masks with a flag, which is good and bad. Good thing is it's kind of cool looking. Bad thing is I can't see their eyes, can't see their face. But it still worked for me. And it's kind of a cool composition. Again, wearing those yellow Nikes. This one here, I moved to a totally different position. This was shot 4 years before, this is in Beijing. And this is with a 400-28 directly into her face from the other fencer.
Had you ever shot fencing before?
Never shot it before. And it's funny, because I tell you about, you know, make sure that you know the sport before you shoot it. I can tell you that one of the challenges for me going to the Olympics is, you know, it's not like there's tons of curling in my area. I did find some, actually, and did practice there. But fencing, I'd never shot. But other than Beijing, it was the first time, and I've learned since then. But the good thing is, if you know your camera, and you know background, good backgrounds from bad backgrounds, and you know how to control shutter speed and all that, you can get good images. I mean, I'm a testament to that. I am not the most amazing photographer in the world, but I know enough to be able to get good images when I need them. And this is what I have clients that tell me. They'll say, we'd like you to come shoot our daughter's bat mitzvah. And they say, do you need to come see, have you ever shot at this temple before? I say, no. Or this party venue? No. Well, you probably should go and visit it. Really? Okay. And then if they really want me to, I will. But honestly, I don't need to, because I can walk into any room and within 30 seconds figure out how I need to shoot it. And it's not that I'm a genius, trust me. It's just I've shot enough. I know, okay, white ceilings, okay, I could probably bounce off of that. White walls, oh no. Green walls, that's gonna bounce green back on there. Okay, I won't use that, I'll use a diffuser. So this is all going through my brain. So like, I don't, like when I walk into a venue like this, I'll try different things. And if it doesn't work, I'll try something different. This one here, you wanna talk about backgrounds? I mean, you know, it doesn't get any better than this. They put the beach volleyball right downtown in London. You see Big Ben, or what we call Big Ben. Big Ben is actually the bell. I got chastised for calling it Big Ben, but for today we're gonna just call it Big Ben. Big Ben here, the London Eye over there, all in the background. So I shot the beach volleyball shots that you saw earlier, and then I hoofed up into a shooting position. So photographers, the way it works is we're allowed, you'll see certain spots where they have benches. That's a photo position, 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 position. No, 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 yes, and then you're allowed, they have one photo position up high, like over here. Well, it was right over all the TV cameras, and it had been raining, so everything was tarped in plastic. I'm like, oh, great shot. So I walked all the way back down again, went up into the stands and shot from here, but I wanted that in the background. So you either want to choose to have a background in, if it's good, or not, if you want to avoid it. This one here, these two people who I don't know. It's funny, when you go to the Olympics, you're in the perimeter the whole time. So it's very rare that you're in the public area. We take press buses, we go underneath the venues, we go straight into shooting positions. So I like to actually get out and feel the vibe from the public. So I was out walking around, but I was going from the velodrome over to water polo, and these people were standing there, and I shot their picture, and I said, do me a favor, and we moved them into position so that the rings were behind them that are there, and it kind of worked. So I sent this to my wife, and the first thing she said is, I want those glasses. Could not find them anywhere. I tried. Finding a good location, and sometimes you can, sometimes you can't. In this case, we were teaching photography to a group of people from Best Buy, and so what we did is we set up a mock rodeo, and we cordoned off a really small area, so everybody was like right next to me. We had 300 people trying to shoot, and we were teaching them, but it was really easy, because I mean, we had a great position. Here, this is in Vancouver, I position myself on the turn so I can kind of get a little bit of the moat to kind of tell you where they're coming from, as opposed to just a dead straight shot. Same thing with this one. Sometimes when you're shooting, luck is involved. This is right as his hand is on the Korean guy. Do you remember when the three Koreans wiped out?
Yeah.
And he ended up winning silver, I believe it was. But this is right as he had his hand there. And you know, part of it's luck, because it happened to be a turn I could shoot. And because I was shooting with fast cards, I didn't have to, you know, wait for buffer clear. I was able to shoot every turn. This one here, I definitely wanted this background, and I definitely wanted to shoot in this position. This is the last turn of the bobsled, this turn 16, they called it Thunderbird. And it's the only one that actually said Vancouver 2010 on it. So I got into a position up on a hill and shot over the crowd and pre-framed it and just waited for a sled to come in and fired off. And even this I shot in burst mode. I got the sled all the way through and then just picked the one I liked. This one, one of my favorite things to shoot, even though I didn't have to shoot it contractually, I loved the horse jumping. It was so cool. And the jumps, the gates were just awesome. They had, you know, Big Ben and they had Stonehenge and all these cool things. But I saw the Olympic rings and I thought, I need that shot. So I parked myself there for about half an hour to get that.
Focused on the fence?
No. Good question though. Did I focus on the fence? I didn't. I could have potentially, but I didn't. What I did was on the 1DX, one of the great things about the 1DX is it's got like 5 billion focal points. So I just went to the very top one and then followed his face, servo focus as he was jumping. I could have probably focused on the fence, but I wasn't sure if he'd be exactly the right plane. And you know, I chose to do that the other way, but I could have. Getting in tight, as I mentioned before, is really important not to shoot too wide. If you have the ability to get in tight, do it. Now this is cheating, this is on the racetrack. Before, so I think this is Scott Dixon, right before his race, and I got right in front of the car, literally, I'm right in front of the nose cone and I'm shooting. Didn't hear them say, photographer is off the track, and all of a sudden I hear this, gentlemen, start your engines, and I look around and I'm the only one out there and I'm like diving over a wall. It was really embarrassing. That was my first time on a track. I've never done it since. But actually, when I shot this, I liked this shot, but one of the things I thought about afterwards, I wish I'd used a flash, because I could have lit him up a little bit better. So I fixed that the next time I was there. Getting it close, yeah, granted, it helps to have a long lens and be there, but to get this close, you know, really helps. The closer you are, the more you are in that action. And this time, when I shot, I really wanted to get a picture of Danica. So, and this time was a year later, and I took a flash into the same type of shot. This is Dario Franchitti, who's the driver for Target Race Team. Actually, is driving drove the Lexar car. The whole car was skinned Lexar last week at Baltimore. It was cool. And he's a driver, and he looks really intense. And you can see the reflection of the car in his glasses. And he just looks like he's in race mode, right? He's tying his shoe. He was up like this on the front tire, and he was tying his shoe. looking like this, and I was right in front of him and just shot it. And it's funny because I just saw him last week, and he signed a picture, this picture, for me. And he goes, "That's a cool shot." I go, "Yeah, you're tying your shoe," and he laughed. 49er game up close. Again, zoom in right in on the quarterback. Try to bring you into the action. This is at the Winter Olympics. Kessler facing off right in front of me. You know, which is always nice when you're in a good position where when they face off, just for me.
And you're through the glass with this,
right? Yeah, it's through plexi.
Do you have to do anything as far as picking up color in the glass?
No, what you do is you get there early to find a piece of glass that's clean. So the shooting positions are generally about five seats in this corner, five seats in this corner, five. So I get to the, because I'm shooting for USA Hockey and contractually obligated to get these shots, I would get there early and find clean glass, and then I'd use my gaffer tape and I'd tape the seat with my business card on the top, basically saying, if you sit here, you die, kind of thing. And then you guard it. And you stay at the venue for 2 hours, and every 20 minutes you walk out there and look to make sure it's still yours. That's what you do. Yeah, so when you're shooting, the question is, when you're shooting without a strobe, how do you deal with exposure and white balance? Well, for one, you can use something to white balance. So I generally would white balance off the ice. So I'll point the camera at the ice with an extra disc on and white balance it. As far as exposure comp, I was generally staying, I might go plus half a stop depending, but a lot of times I just shoot without going plus anything because that buys me a little bit more shutter speed, and then I'll correct it later in Photoshop.
So you shooting manual?
I am shooting manual, yeah.
So what does it make a difference in exposure compensation?
I'm sorry, if I'm in aperture, so I do shoot both ways. I can shoot manual or aperture priority. If I'm in aperture priority, I'll go exposure comp. Manual, we'll adjust the shutter speed accordingly to get us what I want. But generally, I'll stay within a range so that if you look at a histogram, I want to make sure my histogram is somewhere in that last quadrant, even if it's not to the end of it. Just get me somewhere in that quadrant. I can pull it the rest of the way. Does that make sense?
For hockey, you think?
Well, for almost anything.
Well, for hockey, the ice is white, so that would be more of that area.
Correct. Right, so you have to adjust accordingly depending. With hockey, you have a lot of white. If you're shooting the snow, you get a lot of that too, and it goes gray. So then you have to do it. But here's the thing, if you do it in camera and you do it either an exposure comp or you make an adjustment in manual, you're now usually giving up shutter speed. So typically, I need the shutter speed. Now with the newer cameras, like with the 1DX, I could just push the ISO higher. And I could probably go plus one if I wanted to. But typically, I'll just correct it later. This is one of my favorite shots from the entire Olympic Games. And this is a crop. I didn't shoot it this tight. I wish I was that smart to tell you I did. But as a wider shot, one of the athletes from the Team USA, she was getting ready to shoot, she's like this. And I shot it, and I noticed that her tattoo almost matched the arm, but just the shape, the way the hand was, and the water coming off the ball was too cool, so I cropped this. And my buddy who was shooting for Associated Press, he looked at it and goes, "Oh my God, that's a cool shot." And I'm like, "Hey, wow. If I impressed Julio, that's a good thing," because he shot all water polo the entire time. 62 games of water polo, never left the venue. I mean, here's the thing. It's great to be at the Olympics, but I want to be able to go around the Olympics, not just be in one. I mean, I felt sorry for him. I mean, that's really, it's a tough sport to shoot. 62 games. Wow.
You are allowed to crop?
Yes, you can absolutely crop. Now, you can crop. You can't clone. Like, I had a shot in Vancouver, it was a great shot, and the guy's skate from the guy in front of him was sticking into the frame. Well, normally I'd be like, well, knock that out. You can't do that. If you can happen to crop it out, that's fine, but I couldn't, so I had to leave it in. Actually, the shot of the three girls running that we saw with the motion blur with their legs, there's a light right across the top that I hate. Killed to get rid of it, but I can't, so. I was there to shoot water polo only. That was my contract.
But the other photographer.
So the guy from Associated Press. Associated Press, for the first time ever, had people designated to a venue. Usually they float, but they said, "You're going to only shoot horse. You're only going to shoot water polo. You're going to shoot diving. You're going." And like I said, I feel sorry for those guys because, I mean, to me, variety is the spice of life. I want to be able to go out and see different things. So for me personally, I was contractually obligated to shoot water polo, but because I had full credentials, when I wasn't shooting water polo, I could shoot whatever I wanted. Now, if there was a press meeting for water polo, or a practice they wanted me to shoot, or a team party or whatever, I was there. But this shot, it's just different. It's very tight, very close, just like this one. Mikasa, who makes the balls, really likes this shot. But I mean, it's you know, it's cool with the water coming off of it. And that was actually shot that tight.
Is this also in servo?
Yeah, everything's servo. This one here is kind of funny. I was shooting field hockey because my daughter plays field hockey. And she said, Daddy, please make sure you shoot field hockey. So I did. And it was great because this venue happened to be about a 5-minute walk from the press center. So if I had free time, I could just head straight over and shoot. So I was shooting it and got some good action shots. But then at one point, when they have a penalty or the corner ball, whatever they call this thing, they put the ball down and I thought, oh, cool. So I focused just on the ball. There was no foot there. The logo wasn't facing me. It was just a yellow ball. And I thought, that's kind of cool. And then about 10 minutes later, another corner happened and the guy comes down and he puts the ball and the logo is facing right to me. And I'm like, thank you. So I zoomed in, shot that, and shot a couple of them. And then the guy came over and he put his foot there like that with the stick still in the frame and everything, and I shot that one. And I love it. It's just, you know, and again, some people may look at this and go, you're a moron, that's just a weird shot. But I like it. It shows the colors, it tells a little bit of a story about the game. I don't know, it worked for me. Practice. As I mentioned, you don't have to be at the Olympics to do this. You could be anywhere. This is my kids playing in the snow. You want to try shooting a fast shutter speed or a slow shutter speed? Go find action. Anywhere. You walk outside the street right now. We can go shoot. I mean, action's around you. Take advantage of it. This is my daughter when she's a little bit younger, and I wanted to learn how to do motion panning. So I said to her, get on a bike. Go this way, and then go that way, and then go this way, then go that way, then go this way, until I get it right. Okay, what shutter speed should I be at? Should it be 100th? Should it be 20th? Well, it depends how fast she's riding her bike. And also how good I can follow her. So I just practiced. That's my front yard right there. Just had to go back and forth. And if you have willing kids like that, excellent. And of course now, with Facebook, the kids love it. Can I have that, Dad? Yeah. Speaking of being different. It's funny, every time I shot water polo, my first shot was this. And the reason was I was checking my settings. I generally shot manual at ISO 1250, shutter speed of about 1250 at f4 or 5.6, depending what lenses I was using at, somewhere in that range. But I always wanted to make sure I was on. So I'd always shoot one shot of the ball and then check my histogram before every game. And then halfway through the games, I realized that's not a bad shot. It's kind of interesting. So I framed it a little differently so I can include the Olympic rings out in the distance with this kind of floating here with the London and the rings here. And the weird thing is usually in water polo, they throw the ball in the middle and they go. You have your sprinters that come in. Well, the Olympics, they had this on a rope. So they pull the rope down and the thing would just go to the bottom of the pool. So I thought, well, that's kind of cool. And it's just something different. Again, not everybody will love it, but I like it. In Beijing, this was a practice of opening ceremonies. I went and shot that to get some good fireworks shots. A lot of people have this type of shot. But what I liked was this shot. This is during the opening ceremonies, 3 days later. No fireworks, but just the lines. It looks a little bit better on these screens. But you can see the color and how nice it was. And this shot, I really love the shot. For a lot of reasons, the colors are amazing, but it's perfect for my business card. This is my business card because all the dead space up here at the top is where all my text is and down here at the bottom. Now, I wish I could tell you I planned it. I'm not that smart, but it worked. This is in Vancouver. Again, one of the challenges of doing the Olympics is you become immersed in sports and you forget you're actually in that city. So toward the end of the games, I actually went out over to the park and shot back toward the city. And I shot this, I thought that's kind of cool, the way they were lighting the, that actually was where the press center was. This was our home for 3 weeks. And as I was shooting, I looked around and I saw all these people with tripods and cameras. And I realized, oh my God, this is not a unique shot by any stretch of the imagination. Everybody was shooting, you know, not credentialed photographers, but just everybody. So I thought, what could I do different? So, you know, I showed you how I rolled the zoom on that bridge. I did the same thing here. And I love the shot because it was different. You know, remember the old Superman credits at the beginning of the movie? That kind of reminds me of that. This is a 3-second exposure, and it was one, roll, two, stop, three. So that's why you get the rings on both ends of that. It's just and then stop. And everything kind of looks different. This actually made the wall of the press center. They like this shot. Same thing at water polo. Before every game, they would do this. They huddle, they get together, and they do the little their big moment. You get ready for the game. Well, I had shot every shot before this horizontally in a standard landscape type image. And I realized on this one that there was a cool reflection. No one had been in the pool. It was perfectly still. So I reframed it and shot it this way. Different. Partly for keep me awake, but the team loved it. That's cool. You know, we talk about trying to focus on the eyes and, you know, all that. Generally, when I focus, when I'm shooting in this direction, because our shooting positions were on either end of the pool, not on the sides. So when they go that direction, a lot of times I'd pre-focus on the goalie, back focusing. I'd pre-focus on the goalie and then hold it down. And a lot of times I just watch the shot clock. Once it got down to six or five, I knew that their shot was coming. I'd be ready to fire. In this case, I really wanted to get Tony, who's one of the best water polo players in the world, him shooting and just give you a hint of what's going on behind him. So yes, I could have shot this and focused on the goalie, or maybe have them both in focus if I shot at the right aperture. But I like the fact that we're drawn to Tony shooting, and you get the hint of what's going on behind him.
It's still single point. Right?
What's that?
Single point.
Here's what happened. It is a single point focus. Tony's not moving. Tony's got the ball. He's in position. I'll back focus on Tony and then let go. So I've got locked now in focus of where he is. And I can shoot all I want. I can reframe. I can do whatever I want. Now, the minute Tony decides not to shoot and moves and then shoots, I'm in trouble. I got to refocus. But if he stays there like this, I'm fine. So I'll pre-focus many times and then shoot. That's why we use back focus. So toward the end of the games, unfortunately, the women won gold. It was probably the coolest experience ever for me at the Olympics. The men were supposed to do well, and they didn't. They won the first three games and then got their butts kicked for the next five. And the weird thing about water polo Olympics is even though you're not even in medal contention, they still play, which is frustrating both for the athletes, also for the photographer, because I'm shooting like a no game. So my wife was texting me and she was, you know, what are you doing? I said, I'm shooting the loser match. And she's like, what's that? And I know. And I'm like, what am I gonna do now? I mean, so the funny thing is, she says, well, do something different. I said, I'm ahead of you. About 10 minutes ago, I switched. I'm shooting everything 1/100 of a second. Now, would I do that for a gold medal game? No way, because you got to get your safe shot. But here, it didn't really matter, and I wanted to try something different. So what I did was I shot everything 1/100 of a second instead of 1/1000 of a second. Pre-focused on the ball. This is during the sprint as they're all coming in trying to win the draw. And everything else is kind of showing motion except for the ball. Same thing, oh, I didn't show it. Shoot, I have another shot where I did the same thing. I got very cool motion in the water. Just trying something different. Now, when you're shooting sports, the moments are really important. Now, sometimes that's action, sometimes it's reaction. And you want to watch for both. In this case, in the Winter Olympics, he actually scored from this position. Amazing, but true. This is the stick of the American who's basically diving behind the Canadian player and tapping in the puck into an open net at the end of the game. Now, I play hockey. I couldn't even dream this, let alone execute it, but it was cool to catch it.
Do you ever shoot these with just the TV function on the Canon?
So shutter priority?
Yeah, shutter priority. Or you do manual?
Sometimes. Usually aperture priority or manual. I like aperture priority because I want to control my depth of field more than my shutter speed. Although, let me tell you something, and this is something that you all should know. When you're shooting in aperture priority, you should always be looking at the number to your left. What is that shutter speed? Something I tell my kids all the time. Because they'll be shooting, I go, what aperture you at? Oh, Dad, I was at F4. Okay. What was your shutter speed? I don't remember. Really? You don't know. Well, what if you were at 20th? You're not going to be able to hold a 400 millimeter lens at 20th of a second. Not a chance. You need to know. So I'll tell them again. What was it? 60th. That's not going to work. Crank your ISO higher. So whatever mode you're in, you should know your shutter speed. Obviously, if you're in manual, you know because you're setting it. But if you're in aperture priority and you notice that your shutter speed is low, crank up your ISO. So watch that number, and I always do. This is a key moment. This is when they did win that short track speed skating. And I loved it because this kid never thought he'd medal in a million years. And he ended up getting a bronze. But Ono was cool and picked him up and celebrated with him. And that's the spirit of the Olympics. Because the Olympics is not so much about who wins and loses, although that's important. It's about the spirit. And that's what that picture says to me. And I love that. Now, this one here, the Canadian girl won in her home country. It's a big moment for her. It was a horrible moment for me because I was freezing my butt off at the time. It was one time it snowed in Vancouver. I was wearing gloves that weren't waterproof and my hands were like frozen. Now I'm from California. Cold to us is 50. I come here in the winter and I die. Like, you know. So I was dying and I really was not very comfortable. And I'd put my camera down. I was like, I'm done. I just want to go home. And my buddy who's shooting with me from Scotland, he's like, oh no, just hold on. Yeah. I'm like, oh, I'm dying. And this, she won. And I thought, oh, what the heck? And I picked up the camera, I turned it and I fired it. And it looks like the snow has like moved away from her and just snowing around her. And I don't know why, but I just love the colors. I love the reaction, everything about it. It was one of my favorite shots in the games. So I'm glad I picked the camera back up, but I really was not feeling good. At the Summer Games, just a couple weeks ago, I shot this one, never done wrestling before. And if you read my blog, you'll probably notice that I'll never do it again. It stunk. Now, you're talking to a guy who plays ice hockey. I wash my gear like twice a year. I mean, the back of my truck, you don't want to go anywhere within 20 feet of the back of my truck. But I walked into this venue, I was like, oh my God. I texted my wife, like, you'd never last in this venue. It was horrible. It was like BO, just, I don't know. I don't know if it was them or us, but it's weird at the Olympics, they heat the venues. So the velodrome, even if it's 60 degrees outside, the velodrome is like 80 and humid because it's faster. And the pools, here's the way it works. In swimming, diving, and water polo, the temperature in the venue must be the same as the temperature in the pool. So we're dying, sweating, nasty. So I don't know if that was the deal here, but it was brutal. That's all I remember. When I look at this picture, I think, that was a good shot, but oh, it was stinky. So this is funny, because when I was blogging every day, I'll have to go back and read some of my stuff, but if you go back, go to my blog, and you can go through some of the days, you'll see this some of the backstories here. This shot I love for many reasons. This is Jesse Smith from USA Water Polo men's team. And after one of the games, Jesse, whenever his wife came down and handed him his child. Now, there's two shooting positions that I mentioned at the Olympics, this end of the pool and this end of the pool. Well, this is on the side. Now, we're not allowed to go to the side except in between periods. I saw this and I thought, I need that shot. So I said to the person, I need to go over there and get that shot. This is the assistant photo manager at the venue. And she goes, go ask Steve. Steve's the photo manager. And I'm like, okay. I started walking over to Steve and I thought, screw that. There was no time to be asking. I walked, turned, went straight over to him and shot this. Sometimes you need to bend the rules. And I'm glad I did. He loved the shot. I actually sent he was nice. I gave him the shot and some other ones and he gave me his bathing suit from the Olympics, which is kind of cool. Yeah, no, I don't wear it. I know what you're thinking. I tried it on for my wife. It was embarrassing. There's no water polo body here, trust me. But it was really cool. And it was a great moment, not only for me to capture it, but you know, it was great because we started talking and got to know each other. He's a great guy. But if I didn't get the shot, I'd be really upset with myself. And the same thing happened later on the women's team, where the coach from the women's team got his kids, and I did the same thing. Now, I did it and then looked over at the photo manager afterwards, and he gave me a thumbs up like, you're good. He knew it was worth it, and the team loved it. But sometimes you have to kind of push the boundaries a little bit. There was no time to ask, and there was no time to say to his wife, can you hand him the kid back again? You're not gonna recreate a moment. So that was one that I really wanted. So this one here, Merrill Moses is the goalie for the men's team. I had to learn, as I mentioned, I had to learn this game. I didn't understand water polo. But not only learning the game, but I wanted to learn the athletes. So luckily, about a month before the Olympics, they televised a game with the US men playing against Hungary. I think it was down in Southern California. Well, I recorded it on my DVR, and I studied it. Like, I watched it over and over. Which players show reaction? Which ones are the key guys? Who are the big defensemen? The other thing about water polo is it's not just a guy with the ball, but in the 2-meter position in front of the net. is where the strongest guys are, and they're fighting for position, literally clawing, bleeding, going over each other, beating each other. I mean, it's brutal. So sometimes I would key in on just that action. But what I noticed when I watched the video is the men, when in ice hockey, when we score a goal, it's like a scrum. Yeah, and everybody gets together, and we're all high-fiving and going nuts. In water polo, these guys would score a goal, and they're cool, and they'd swim away. And I'm like, what, that's it? You know, you might get a fist pump, maybe. But Merrill, he showed emotion every time. When they scored, he was excited. When he made a big stop, he'd do that, like, that face. So I knew that. So whenever they scored, I knew that most of the guys shooting weren't doing anything, but I'd always go and I'd focus on Merrill, even though he was on the other side of the pool, to get that shot. Same thing at Wimbledon. I really wanted to shoot center court. I was excited, but I got some great reactions. And again, this is not during the game, I mean, you know, during the actual point, but after the point. This shot, this is Wozniacki, who's playing against Serena and got her butt kicked. It was like 6-1, 6-love. But the one game that she won, she knew she was losing, but she was like, hey, at least I won one. And that was great. That was fun. The one bad thing about the Olympics was, I don't know if you heard about that here on NBC, but there were so many empty seats. It was really frustrating. And you'll see the white on them, that's designated. So ours were pink, and it said photographer use only. And the white ones, I think, were either for sponsors or something, but it was really frustrating to have pictures of Serena Williams surrounded by emptiness. So what do? You shoot really tight. And this was a crop. I did crop on this, but man, she's just, this woman's strong, and you know, I'm looking for that emotion. Yeah. Same thing here. This is when James won the 400 meter race. Yeah. And it was great, because as he ran, I said, make sure when you finish and win gold, you turn, look right at me. Just got lucky. Came in, almost looked right at us. In some of the venues, like when I was shooting at opening ceremonies, I had to work myself into a different position, so I was right by the family members. Which is great, because when a U.S. team comes out, who the first thing they're going to turn to? Mom and dad and family. And I've got pictures of Kerry Walsh and those guys going, right at me. I mean, it looks like they're at me. I love that. I mean, for opening and closing ceremonies, we're in the stands in sitting positions.
Did you tilt the camera a little on
this? Yeah, on this one here, no, I was fairly straight. There were times where I'd tilt the camera, and if I had to stay in frame. And honestly, there's times when you're trying to get the shot. I'll straighten later. I wish I could say I'm so good as always perfectly straight, but they're not. This one here was a critical moment for me. I will tell you that when they won gold, actually before they won gold, the day before this match, we knew they were gonna win silver or gold. US has never won a gold medal in women's water polo. This is a huge deal to them. And because I was shooting for this team, I felt like I was part of the team. So we had like 20 emails and phone calls and meetings all to discuss what happens if they win gold. So I told them, I will shoot the living daylights out of this game. So don't worry, the hammer's down, I will shoot. I shot this one game, it's not even 1 hour long, the one game in the medal ceremony, I shot 74 gigabytes. Yike. I mean, you talk about the celebration, when they got their gold medal and they all came up like with their hands in the air, I've got tick, 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 I mean the whole thing, because I'm not missing it. And so I shot a ton of images here. And the good thing was, USA Water Polo told them, there's gonna be a ton of photographers. The one you wanna look at is Jeff. So I had an advantage. So I actually told all the girls, okay, do this, good. Now everybody bite your medals. And I was directing, everybody else was shooting over my shoulder. And literally, you're fighting for position. You have 30 people all trying to get the shot. So you throw an elbow, another elbow, you know. And then we had guys that were standing up in front of you, you kick them, like, get down, like, you know, it's crazy. But you gotta get your shot. So in this, I have other shots I have where I kinda had to crop to get other cameras out of the picture and stuff. This one here, I was up front. Different lenses, you know, and here's the thing. A lot of people, when they think sports, they think long lens, right? You know, to separate, you wanna use a 400 or 500 or whatever. Well, you know, not always. So this is river rafting. I threw a fisheye on here because I wanted to kind of magnify the kayak versus her. This is my daughter swimming. And again, this was just me trying something different. I said, I've shot so many swim meets. I'm gonna go there with a fisheye lens. No long lens today, just a fish. So I shot, that's her diving. This is her coming in to the block, and I'm shooting underneath the diving block. Is it a great image? Yeah, it's okay, but it's different. Something that most people don't see when they look at a photo. And I can guarantee you there's no one else at my swim club shooting that shot. So it's different, I like that. This is the shot I told you about. This is my number one shot from Vancouver, most requested image for USA Hockey. And this was pre-focused. Do you see the boards? This is the boards on both sides. So I'm literally inches from the glass, and he's about a foot from me. So here's the way I shot this. Most of the time I'm shooting with a 70 to 200 through the plexi, okay? What I did is I had a 5D Mark II with a fisheye, and what I did was before the game even started, I went up to a guy about a foot from me, and I pre-focused right on his eyes, okay, good. And then I turned off the focus, and I took gaffer tape, and I gaffed the lens so it wouldn't shift focus. And I just threw it on the ground. And then whenever they'd come into my corner, I'd drop the 7200 with the 1D Mark IV, and I'd grab the 5D Mark II and just go and just shoot. And I got the, you know, perfect curve. I mean, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But in this case, it really worked well. And that's kind of thinking through what might happen in the action.
So he actually was probably out of focus on the approach.
Oh, yeah.
Had reached that exact moment.
Yeah, he was out of focus up until right when he's, I mean, literally, I mean, like that glove is probably, you know, a mere 6 inches from the camera lens. Is my guess. I mean, he's right there.
There's a lot of depth of field on a fisheye, right?
There's a ton of depth of field on a fisheye, so it lets me, you know, here's the great thing. Yeah, I get this, but look, I even have the rings from the scoreboard info, you know. I know. Yeah, it's pretty incredible. And the wider you shoot, the more depth you generally will have. And this is why when we talk about image stabilization, do I wish Canon put IS on the new 24 to 70? Yeah, it'd be nice. But honestly, when I'm shooting with a wider lens, you don't need it as much. You know, you sound like you know what you're doing. Do you use IS on a wide lens?
If I have it, sometimes.
Yeah, if you have it. There you go. Yeah, and there's times when it's good to have, but something like this, you don't need it. I mentioned that during the BMX, I decided to try a wide instead of the long lens. So, you know, there's the starting ramp in London there. Up there, I had the blimp. These guys coming through, cool jumps, and I thought, oh, I'm gonna go wide. So I went to a position, a photo position where I'm literally feet from these guys as they're coming through and they're heading toward the finish line, and just kind of framed it and shot this. And same thing, burst mode, kind of following them, boom, 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 the whole way. This one. This is the kayaking venue, which I really liked as well. I had shot all the long shots using that 200 to 400. What they had done is, in this venue, they didn't want you going up too close to the edge because they didn't want you falling in. And that's not what you want to be on TV for, let me tell you. So what they did is they took spray paint, a different color green from the turf, and they spray painted a line all the way along the river, this man-made river, and they said you have to stay behind there. And even if you put your monopod over the line, you're in trouble. Well, what I did was I shot out the whole race. This is the press center and family seating. So I was on my way heading out of there, heading to the press bus to go back into downtown London. So I thought, oh, this is my last shot. I want to get a fisheye shot. So what I did is I got to that line on the ground, I'm laying down. I got, and I pre-focused my lens right to this pole and waited for this kayak to come, and I just went like this. And I stuck my hand and I'm literally right over the edge of the edge of this thing. And these people are probably a couple feet from me as well. And I'm just like bum, 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 bum. And hoping, and I got the whole turn, you know, all the way through the gate. And then I see the photo manager kind of look at me, and I'm like, and he goes, and that was that. And then I left, so it was fine. You know, it was one quick shot. They're not gonna, you know, complain too much. Now, if I drop the camera in the water, actually, I think I'd be crying before he would. So, because remember, it wasn't mine, it was Canon's. I'd owe him 8,000 bucks or whatever.
Do you use this with a spot metering if you, sun's in a position where you have to,
or
you just...
Usually I'm in evaluative metering. There are times I'll spot meter, but rarely. Especially in sports, pretty rare. When I'm shooting things like a bar mitzvah or wedding, I might spot meter on the face of that person up at the front, especially depending on the lighting around them. Right. Yeah.
But what if the sun is sort of shooting into the light?
Well, if I'm shooting in light and I have a bunch of shadows, I could either do that or I'll open it up either in exposure. Yeah. Yeah. Having fun, and this is the key. I don't know if you guys can tell. I mean, I do have fun doing this. I feel like I'm the luckiest guy in the world many times just to have the ability to do all this stuff. But I like to have fun. This is a fun shot I did in Vancouver. This is with a 1D Mark IV at, you know, 10 or 12 frames a second. And literally the frame before this, there's no spit, and the frame after this, there's no spit. It was a quick just, and you know, it's funny. This one here, so I was shooting the first women's hockey game, US versus China, I think it was. And I'm shooting, and during one of the breaks, I'm always looking around. So during opening ceremonies, when the teams march in and it's boring as all get out, because like hours of, you know, Serbia and, you know, the next one, and they all walk in, and you're like, ah, and this is when we go eat and do all that and come back, because USA is always you. We're at the end. So for the first hour, I'm gone. But I'm walking around. I'm looking for people that are walking outside that are dressed in British garb or, you know, Irish flags, whatever we have. This one here, I turned around and I saw this little baby, and just to me, it spoke Canada. You know, these people are proud to be the Olympics, and I loved it. So first thing you do, ask for permission. So you don't usually want to shoot pictures of people, although granted, the Olympics, they're all, they love it. Like, you turn around, they're all like, ah! But for them, because it was a young child, I said, can I shoot a picture of your child? And they said, sure. And I did, and I turned the camera around, and I said, look what I just did, and they said, oh, wow. And so next thing I did, give my business card, and I make sure to tell them, email me, I'm not charging you. So whenever I shoot pictures of people, like on the streets, if I get a good shot, I'll show someone. I always give my card and say, I'm not going to charge you for this. Just email me, I'll send it to you. And I do it because I love it. And to be able to provide someone an image like that is cool. You know? It's a feel-good moment. What always amazes me, though, is when they don't write back and say thank you. That kind of bugs me. They usually do. Sometimes they don't.
Do you send them a print or a digital?
No, digital. No. Print's too much of a pain. You know, if they live in my area, I'll say, come on by, I'll make a print for you. Oh, yeah, good question. How do I know who's who? I tell them, here's my card. Please email me and say, we're the ones with the baby at the hockey game.
Because shot one baby.
Yes, I shot one baby that day. And sometimes I'll take it down on my iPhone and say, kid with Canada hat, here's their email address, and I'll email them. Generally, I'll get my card and put the onus on them to contact me. But I shot this one Bobby, this policeman in London, at Greenwich at the horse racing, and really cool shot of him. Gave my card, and he just emailed me a couple days ago. And I said, yep, here's your image, digital.
Do you seek model releases so you can use
these? I don't seek model releases. I do use them on my blog. If someone doesn't want to be on my blog, they can always ask me to take it off, and I will. But I use my blog, but I don't sell them ever. I couldn't sell them because I don't have model releases. But here's the thing. Here's the weird thing. I own every image that I've shot, including the ones at the Olympics. I own those. But when you shoot the Olympics, the IOC controls them. So I can only sell my images for editorial use only. So if someone says, hey, can I get that image? I want a picture of Michael Phelps in my room. I want to buy it off you. I can't sell it. Not unless I pay IOC and pay Michael Phelps. So it's very restricted. In this case, when I shot these people, it was a cool moment. I said, hey, give me a thumbs up or whatever they did, and I shot it. They knew. I told them, I said, look on the internet tomorrow on USA Water Polo's Facebook page, you'll see this. They knew it was going to the net. So, yeah. This one here, again, trying to be different. So I was shooting tennis, getting bored. I looked over and I saw this ball girl with a mohawk. And I thought, would they allow that at Wimbledon? Normally? Because, you know, normally at Wimbledon, you can't wear anything other than white. So this was the rare time when the tennis players could wear colors. So anyway, I thought that was kind of funny. So instead of focusing on the tennis player, I focused on the ball girl. And I waited for her to serve because I wanted that to be my background. But I wanted the focus to be here. Here's a funny story. I put this on my blog. And about a week ago, I got an email from her saying, hey, I saw your blog. That's me. And if you look at my blog, you'll see her comment where she says, I actually have that. They weren't very thrilled. I've been a ball girl at Wimbledon for a while. They weren't really thrilled about the hair. They're getting used to it now. It was great. So I wrote back and said, well, give me your email address. I want to send you the picture. But she wrote to me anonymously, so I'm hoping that she goes back and looks again because I want to send her that photo. This last shot, this is me at the water polo, my second home for a month. At the water polo facility. I actually had a wide lens on. I was doing some shots, and I handed it to another photographer and asked him to shoot it. That's the 200 to 400 lens. A lot of people ask about the vest that we were wearing. And as we talked about before, they are color-coded. But here's the way it works. You wear credentials, and you wear them all the time. So when you're at the Olympics, when I fly to the Olympics, you wear it on the plane. because you get special access both getting off the plane, going through security and everything else. But every time, every year you go to the Olympics, you wear these. Restaurants, everywhere. And the vest you don't have to wear, but in order to get into a shooting position, even if you have your credentials, you cannot shoot in a shooting position unless you have the vest. Because that way they can see from 100 feet back who belongs and who doesn't. And so you have to wear them, and you can imagine how they smell after 3 weeks of the Summer Olympics. Because you can't wash them, there's no time. But anyway, so you have to wear them, and those are your designation, and so you live in these things. The one other thing I should mention is, when you watch the Winter Olympics coming up in Russia, you'll see us not wearing vests, but you'll see us wearing sleeves. And the reason is because we're all wearing big jackets. So they don't want to make it, then they won't be able to see who belongs. So what we do is they give us a sleeve that you wear on your arm that designates you as a photographer. So just FYI.
Yeah. So they send you this vest before you leave the building.
So here's the way, no, they actually don't. Here's the weird thing. They don't send us these in advance. This is the challenge. The first time I did my Olympics, I was nervous. I seriously did not sleep well for 6 weeks. I did not know what lenses to bring, what to expect. And it was really nerve-wracking. This is my third one now. I've got it down to a science. So I only bring, my longest lens I bring is like a 70 200, maybe the 100 400, and that's it. All the other lenses I'm borrowing from Canon, God bless them, they're great when we're there. They have a huge allotment of cameras and lenses we got. They did pre-ship me two 1DXs that I could use and take with me that I still have. Please let me keep them. They won't, but a guy can dream. So what I do is I bring a small allotment of lenses, the smaller stuff. This low pro bag went, and my 200 roll, the low pro X200 roller is a godsend because seriously, my back by day 12 or something, my back was killing me. So I use the rolling bag almost everywhere. Monopod, the Gitzo monopod that folds down really small. Love that thing. That was like that one there was my godsend. You want a monopod when you're using long lenses like this because you break your back. You can't handhold these for hours.
About 7200.
7200, I would sometimes use a mono, but I'll hand hold a 7200, no problem. But these big ones, like, you know, 400 or 500, no way. And then what you do is, when I got to the Olympics, I now know, in Beijing, they sent us our credentials in advance. But the weird thing is, in both in Vancouver and in London, they just sent us the paper one. And you have to bring that, you don't want to mess it up, because that's what they laminate. So now you take that to the right station, they laminate, they check your ID, they, you know, retinal scan, body check, they make sure you are who you are, you get your credentials. Well, then you go to the press center, and I know the way it works. First thing I do when I get to the press center is I go get my vest, I get my media pack, which has, it's a backpack, Olympic backpack, and it's got tons of media guides and rules and venue shooting position changes and all that stuff, and I start studying that. And then I go and I get my locker, because there's only a certain amount of lockers in each one of these. So I have a locker in the main press center where I keep some gear, and I have a locker at water polo that was my home, that little box. And I went and I got those day one, because sometimes they run out. And so there's a certain method that I've gotten good at, which makes it easier every time I go, because I've learned their way. But it can be it's a really daunting task when you get there, when you're fighting with 2,000 other people for the same press buses and things, and it's it takes some figuring out.
When you were just going back to the museum, when you were taking pictures of just passerbys in the museum, did anybody give you a hard time? Taking my picture, you know.
Yeah, the question is, when I'm shooting like in the museum, does anybody give me a hard time? You know, not really. And a couple reasons. One is I'm pretty careful not to be in someone's face. I have one shot. Oh, what the heck? I'm just gonna show it to you. These are unedited, so bear with me here. I'll show you Photo Mechanic. So here's my shots. So you can find it. So I was doing motion blur by the love sign. I was basically, here's what I did. I gave myself a task. I like to do that. And this time it was, everything's gotta be motion blur, except for this shot. Here's a guy. I see this picture. Like I said, I don't really understand modern art completely. So here's a white painting on a white wall. Very confusing to me as to how that's art, but whatever. So, but I see this one guy in a white shirt sitting there, and I love that. He's in a red shirt in front of all white. So I shot this. Now it needs to be edited. He needs to be brightened. Well, it's better on these, but he needs to be brightened, and I'll do a little bit of tweaking to this. But you know, I just kind of stood there and I quickly shot it. He was looking at his phone. He didn't even notice me. But the rest of the time, you know, I'm shooting. That was for my wife. She likes modern art. Let me see, find some of the motion blur stuff here. Where I'm just kind of looking down. You know, some of these worked, some didn't. So especially when you're looking down, no one's gonna care. Now, if I'm looking straight down on a woman, she might care. But I generally, I'm pretty careful about the way I'm shooting. And again, if I want to shoot a picture of someone and they're looking at me, or like I did this one picture in London that I'll show you. These girls were standing by Big Ben. Didn't know who they were. They were facing the other direction. It was just the back of them. And they had the Union Jacks around them. And I thought, that's kind of cool, so I was shooting. And then I don't have a flash, actually, I probably did, but I wasn't using a flash. I didn't have it, actually. But there was a street light right here. So I thought, that'd be cool. So I went up to him. And of course, I'm wearing the vest, so they know I'm a photographer. I go, hey, I'm a photographer for the Olympics. I'd love to get a picture of you guys. Can you do me a favor and turn with your backs toward me? And then I said, and then that we did. And it didn't really work. And I said, can you guys move more into the light there? And just stay really still, because I want motion of everybody else around you. Okay. And then they turned, and we did one with them facing me, which is this one here. And it turns out that this girl, their sisters, the one girl here, actually worked in the main press center. Go figure. So she emailed me and I sent her the picture. But you know, I'll just ask them and say, you know, I'll send it to you. Can I take your picture? And actually, most people are very willing, even without me saying I'll send it to you. Can you turn around like this picture? Sure. Once in a while, you get someone who goes, no.
Right.
And you respect that. But you do it with a smile, you know. And actually, I tell this to people, you gotta do everything with a smile. You know, when I went to the opening ceremonies, when I went to the US Olympic Committee, you have to actually bid for, your credentials do not get you into those events. Even though I had top level credentials, there are certain events which are called high impact events. So that's opening ceremonies, closing ceremonies, and all the swimming finals, and I think like women's gymnastics finals might have been impacted as well. So you have to actually get a ticket into a photo position. And you have to like beg for that. So you can't go to the USOC and say, I want my ticket. And I see people do this all the time at the airport. I want first class. Oh yeah, she's incentivized to take care of you, right? But if you go up and you're nice to people, it's amazing what'll happen when you just smile and say, hey, what can we do here? So opening ceremonies, I got a ticket in, and it was the worst possible shooting position. And so I looked and I said, this is it? He goes, yeah. I go, oof, anything better? He said, well, we might have a better. I said, really? I'll follow you back. So we walk back to the main press center and we talk to the photo manager. And he goes, yeah, we might have a different ticket for you. I go, tell you what, I'll just sit here and relax. So I parked up right outside his office for about 45 minutes just on my iPhone. Every time I walk by, I go. And he got sick of seeing me. Finally, he just took my ticket. He wrote head position, which is the best place. And I went. But I did it with a smile. And I didn't bug him, and you know, and I was appreciative. I thanked him, and sometimes I would actually get their email and send him an email saying, thank you again for that. You know, and it's amazing what being nice actually gets you in life in general, right? And I think, to me, when I look at photography, photography opens up a world to me. It allows me to talk to someone on the street that I normally wouldn't talk to. It allows me to meet people when I'm at a restaurant that I normally wouldn't meet. It's a cool thing. And I think the most important thing to me is it lets me see the world in a totally different way. I see light differently. I see people differently. I see beauty in a whole different way than I did 10 years ago. When I'm shooting a family for the first time, or if I'm doing, let's say, a bar mitzvah, and I've got a boy who's 13, he doesn't want his picture taken, especially the boys. Girls, maybe. The boys at 13, they're like, yeah, whatever. And then you got mom behind you, smile! You know, but what I do is I take and I say, Mom and Dad, I go to Jacob and I are going to be gone for about 5 minutes. We're going to go shoot in the back of the temple. See ya. Go do what you have to do. And we go, just the two of us. And what I do is I'll take the first shots of him. And I'm shooting at 2.8. And so he's like, but behind me is a dumpster and a bush. Trust me, that bush is going to be a beautiful green backdrop. So I take a bunch of pictures, right? And I have him stand and maybe instead of just doing this, I might have him turn this way and look at me a little bit like this or whatever. And I do it. In the first minute, I go, hey, Jacob, look at this. And I show him the back of the camera, and he goes, wow. And the girls do this too. Wow, I look good. Yeah, you do. And that's my job, is to make you look good. All of a sudden now, their barrier goes down, They're more relaxed. They know that you're actually going to make them look good, not like a dork, right? And you get, then you can get great shots. And I do this all the time when I'm shooting events. I'll try, if I get a great shot, I'll do it. Look at this. Hey, Grandma, look at this one. Oh my God, that's so cute, right? For a lot of reasons, Grandma's happy, but everybody's more relaxed. You become part of that party. And it's important when you're shooting. When I'm shooting, I mean, and I'll do, I even did this with the athletes. If I got good shots, like that one of Jesse and his kid, I turned around and said, hey, Jesse, look at this. And actually, the greatest compliment I had was the gold, when the woman won gold, we were editing till 2 a.m. To get images for USA Today and everybody else. And then they said, come join us at the gold medal party. Now, I didn't shoot the gold medal party because this is a private party for them and I wanted to just enjoy it. I wanted them to enjoy it and I just want to enjoy it. So I went to the party. Some of the girls came up to me and said, you know what? After every game, we'd run to Facebook to see what you got. Okay, I can tell you I did not shoot the Olympics for money. The money is horrible. I lost probably 10 grand in shooting for what I made doing the Olympics. I don't do it for the money. But that is awesome. When the, you know, and I'm on Facebook with a lot of the girls now, and they're like, hey, can you send me another picture? I'm like, it's great. You know, when the coach of the women's team asked me, I FTP'd him a ton of images. You know, it's something that we can provide to people that they don't have, and it's that passion. That's why I do it. Now, granted, I make more money after doing the Olympics. Now I'm a 3-time Olympic photographer. When I'm at home, I can charge more. So it makes you more money in the long run. But trust me, shooting the Olympics, I won't tell you exactly how much I made, but it was a pittance. And yet I was liable, if I missed a water polo game, I was liable for $10,000. Whoops. And trust me, they paid me not even close to that amount. So, but they sponsored my credential and I got to go to the Olympics and have the best seat in the house for all these events. You don't complain, right? Yeah, it is priceless. And you know, and honestly, I hope everybody in this room shoots because we love doing it. You know, and how many people here have gotten a money shot? Like they look and go, oh my God. Really, no one? Not even you?
Yeah.
You have. You, a couple of you guys. Let me tell you something, the first time it happens, you will be blown away. Because there's no, I cannot stand here in front of you and tell you what it'll feel like, because you won't know. But when you get it, oh my God. And I'll tell you what, I shot 78,000 shots at the Olympics, of which I kept 38,000, of which 125 made my favorites, of which maybe 3 I really love. Now I'm getting more picky as I shoot. But I mean, it gets harder to get that moment. But when I shoot, like if you look at my blog, actually my Facebook page, I did a bat mitzvah a couple weeks ago, and this girl Jenna, I've done her whole family, she's the last kid, which bums me out. I told them, I said, you need to have more kids or get them married, because I love hanging out with your family. But she's 13, cute as can be, and when she's doing the candle lighting ceremony, I shot it with the Sigma 85-1.4, wide open, no flash, just the candlelight in front of her. And I edited it and I was like, wow. Now, the family goes, oh, that's a beautiful picture. And I'm on a scream, no, it's not, it's amazing. Like, you know, I like it more than they do. And I'm like, no, really, that's a great shot. But, you know, like when I shot the shots yesterday that I showed you at the museum, I haven't gone through them really yet. But this morning, first thing I did when I woke up is I had to download, I got to see what I got. Right, it's like trying to find those jewels, you know, and that's the fun. And to me, to have that ability to get that killer shot, even if the family doesn't appreciate it as much as they do, this family does. But I want that. I want that feeling of like, wow, that was cool.
How long do you spend editing pictures?
You know what? That's a good question. How long do I spend editing photos? You know, it depends on the photo. The most I've probably ever spent on any of the photos that you've seen, any of these, is probably 10 minutes, tops. You know, the one good thing is that you get better at shooting, you edit less because you're shooting more accurately right out of the camera. But there are times like, I'll show you this one shot. This one here, I shot last day I was there, or the second last day I was there. And I edited this one because I wanted the way I shot it, the clock face was too bright. So I actually, you know, went and toned down that one, brightened certain areas, darkened certain areas, you know, did a little bit of sharpening and stuff. But I still probably spent no more than 10 minutes on it.
CS5?
CS6. Yeah. But, you know, it just, I'm trying to think if I've done any, images where I've spent, you know, half an hour or a lot of time. Not really. Spice Girls, you know, no editing there. Not, you know, honestly, I'm trying to think, like, if I look at my favorite stuff. You know, like, I when I shoot models, or this is my neighbor, you know, I'll do skin smoothing and some stuff like, you know, and adjustments. Like this one here, you know, skin smoothing, get rid of things, maybe pop the colors a little bit and contrast a little bit, but still no more than a couple minutes.
Camera Raw.
I don't use, so Camera Raw is my first step. So what I do is I'll go in and make adjustments in Camera Raw, and then when I do the skin smoothing and cloning and stuff, I'll go into Photoshop and do it.
Once for like an hour,
good question.
Or do you go back over and over?
I go through them once, and I hit tag on Photo Mechanic. I just go tag, tag. So the one thing, I was telling you about how fast this is. So here's my images. These are raw images from yesterday. So you have to bear with me because they're complete. Some of them are junk. But watch how fast I can go through raw.
How many megapixels?
Full. This is 20. Was it 18 or 20? Whatever the 5D Mark III is, huh? These are all at full.
No,
I mean,
can you zoom in?
Oh yeah, so if I want to look, like, is this scrolled sharp? No.
Wow.
So like I'll go like this one here, let's see. Like, you know, is she sharp? No, definitely not, right? But the painting sharp, that's what I was focused on. So what I'll do is I'll go through and go, yes, 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 no, 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 no. And then I'm tagging. And so I'm hitting T for tag if I don't like it. No, tag, tag, tag. So I go through my images one pass. And then I do Command T, which is select all tagged, and delete. So those are now gone. Then I make a second pass, and I go through and say, ooh, I like that one, I like that one. And so I rank them by color coding. And then when I do that, I then filter and say, show me all pictures that are ranked. And I may have, you know, from yesterday, I'll probably end up with, you know, 12 or 15 that I like or whatever. And then I'll edit those 12 or 15 and put them on the blog. What's that? How much is Photo Mechanic? You know what? Bear with me. I think it's about 150 or 200 bucks. Yeah, and here's the thing. It doesn't do all the stuff that Lightroom does. It doesn't let you adjust white balance and exposure. It just lets you pick what you want, get through it. But here, let me tell you my trick, and I've done this when I spoke about shooting events here. Here's my kicker. When I shoot a bar mitzvah or wedding, I'm shooting it, and they're going straight to a lunch party. So I'm shooting family pictures in the morning at 9 o'clock. 10 o'clock, we're done. I shoot the service from 10:30 to 12:30, and then they go to a party, lunch party. I have about 10 minutes to where everybody is talking, and then they move into the lunch party. I run over, I set up my laptop, I download, because I'm using the fast memory cards and fast reader and fast computer. I download, and I don't delete. All I'm doing at that point is, which ones are good? Oh, I like that one, I like that one, I like that one, I like that one, I like that one. About 5 minutes later, select all, Command L, slideshow. So inside of Photo Mechanic, you can actually do a slideshow. So let's do. So let's just go to favorite folder, and I want to do all these. Command A for select all, Command L for slideshow, and now 2 seconds later, I have a slideshow. Now remember, these are shots of the bar mitzvah that just happened 10 minutes before, and they're rolling like this. Two reasons I do it. One is it's cool because most people can't do it. But here's the other thing: people freak out. Who am I surrounded by at a bar mitzvah? Another 100 Jewish people with kids about the same age. This is my marketing. And the best part is you get to rent your projector and screen and make money for your marketing. It's unbelievable. So I roll these, and here's what I do. 2 hours into the party, they've seen them, right? The same 100 images have been rolling for 2 hours. So what do? They're eating dinner. I pull it down. I quickly download the first 2 hours of the party, and then they look up from their salad, and all of a sudden they have the first 2 hours of the party running during the second 2 hours. Pretty cool. And the reason I can do it is I just do it all in Photo Mechanic, and I'm just flying and ranking the stuff I like and then throwing it up there. You don't have to export anything. It's nope, this is all. I mean, I could do a slideshow with the raw files I just did yesterday. So these are unedited raws. I go Command A, Command L, boom, watch this. Same thing. So what it's doing is it's using the preview JPEGs. It's that fast.
It's using the JPEG for the camera?
Yeah, whenever you shoot a RAW, it creates a preview JPEG. So it's really using the preview JPEG. This program, to me, like I said, everybody at the Olympics uses it for that reason. Because we don't want to do all the modifications in Lightroom. We just want to go, which ones are our winners?
So when you bring that photo into Camera Raw, it's totally different.
Watch this. Okay, I want to bring, let's say I want to bring this particular photo into Camera Raw. Let's do...
So it's not going to have that saturation, that sharpness. That
right. But what, yeah. No, it's not. And the thing is, that's why you got to be able to shoot decent, because you're showing your junk, right? You're showing a raw file. So I'll look at it and go, oh God, it's a little yellow or a little crooked. Mom looks at it and goes, oh my God, Joey's beautiful. They don't care. Oh, the sharpness is off by 15%. And you know what? The straightness is off by 3%. I know it's off by 3%. I know my photos. They don't give a rat's, you know what, about that. All they care about is that is a good image. We're way more picky. We better be way more picky than our client.
Can you show that gymnastics picture where the girl is over the balance?
Yeah. Yep. What I want to show you though is, let's say I want to edit this photo. I hit E on my keyboard. Watch this. There it is. It's now in Camera Raw. And now I can do whatever I want to it. It automatically opens it how I want it. I'll show you the gymnastics one in a minute. Yeah. Sorry? Yes, you can say, so you can do all kinds of stuff here. So if I want to do a select, let's say I want to select these images for my blog, I can go save as. And I can save as to 800 pixels, which is nice and small, and watermark it with my Jeff Cable Photography. Where do I want to watermark it? Dead center? Yes. Or off to the side? Sure. Hit OK. And then put it into a folder called blog or whatever, and it's done. And then you can also FTP directly from the application. I don't very often, but I can. Yeah, it's a godsend. This thing, you know, it's an amazing program. If you guys have additional questions, I'll stay up here. Although we have pretty tight time, because I have to grab something quick to eat and then come back for the next one. But come up and I'll show you the picture. Thanks.
For more information, please visit us online, give us a call, or stop by our New York City Superstore. You can also connect with us on the web.